I have also been a literature student all my life, and as much as I love Rushdie and I love Angati Roy and I love Amitav Ghosh, I think one, the success speaks for itself. There is no doubt about the fact that he sells. Yes, a lot of people attribute that success to him being very smart about what he does, etc., etc. But this session is not about those things. This video is not about those things. This video is essentially about the three mistakes of my life. I'll take you through the story, and in between I'll tell you the things that I love about it. It's a story of three friends, Govind, Omi and Ishan. And three friends who come from pretty much the same backgrounds. Ishan comes from a very basic middle class family. His father is working in a telephone exchange. So there's enough money, just about enough money, which is the case with every middle class family, and there are always certain constraints. And yes, there are a lot of landlines in the house, but that's about it. Govind comes from a family of priests. His father is a priest in the Swaminath temple in Ahmedabad, and the entire trust is in his mother's name. Govind, on the other hand, who is the narrator of the story, who is in a way the protagonist of the story, and Chetan Bhagat uses him as a narrator from the very beginning because he is the one who has already committed suicide. He's popping pills all night, and he's written an email simultaneously to Chetan Bhagat himself, who reads this in Singapore and then decides to find out, because he's worried somebody has sent him a suicide note, and he tries to find out everything he can about the guy the next day. And eventually, because of his pre-existing connections in Ahmedabad, being a student there in IMA, he gets in touch with one of the faculty members there and eventually finds out that he is in the General Civil Hospital in Ahmedabad. Bhagat makes the journey, and it is Govind then on that hospital bed who narrates him the entire story of this novel. These three friends, I was talking about Govind, yes, his father left his mother and him when he was very, very young. He left them for another wife that he had in a different part of the city and never came back. His relationship with his mother obviously is a very important one here. Govind as an individual, and he talks about this in the context of the entire Gujarati community. Gujarat is one of those very rare states in India where you're more valued if you have a business rather than just going for a cushy job that gives you a comfortable life or, you know, security or whatnot. It's a state where people tend to be more excited about business. And Govind is one of those people. And it's not just that, it's because of the community and the entire atmosphere in the state that he feels this way. Coming from a very challenging financial background, where he saw his mother sell jewelry for as long as she could, till she eventually ran out of it after his father leaves the family. And among other things, Gopal was exceptional at mathematics growing up. He fell in love with that subject very early on. He believes in logic. It is a subject that has defined his personality also to a large extent. And it was only after he got 100 marks in class 10th that people also suddenly realized, okay, right? And you know the condition of mathematics in India. Somebody getting 100 marks in class 10th back in the 90s, it was huge, right? And maths and the failure or the scare that people had in their hearts as students in class 8, 9, 10th, 12th, it had already reached epic proportions in the country. So he became one of those very popular tutors in the community where he started teaching people from a very early age because he got 100 marks in mathematics by himself. That is where he starts earning money for the first time. And that is what made him fall in love with business in the first place. Right? It was not just about a better lifestyle. It was not just about a new couch. It was not just about buying a new cooler and, you know, being more comfortable. It was also about the respect that people gave you. It was about the fact that they were not scared now when the owner of the house came to collect his rent. It was more about the fact about the power which he got when he used to go to a shop. People were not worried if their money is ever going to come back, right? Even if he takes something on credit. So that gave him respect for the first time, and he completely fell in love with the idea of business. That is what he wanted to do growing up. Of course, his big challenge was the lack of capital in his life. Ishan, the other friend, whose father works in a telephone exchange, he got selected for NDA, and a year into NDA, the National Defense Academy, on his way to become an army officer, he quit and came back. Ishan's problem was that he could not handle unquestioned authority. And as much as that move, that act of coming back from NDA frustrated his father and disappointed his... I mean, he was completely disappointed in his son for practically the rest of his life. His father had given up. It was a big dent in his heart, and I mean, if you think about it from the parents' perspective, of course it makes sense that he was angry with him. They consistently got into arguments, quarrels, and his father used to completely, you know, downplay him all the time. There was a lack of ambition. He had been in love with cricket all his life, but I mean, in cricket, that was a very different time in this country. Either you made it to the national team, either you made it to those top 11, 20 people, or you were a failure, right? Things like IPL did not exist back then. Now, at least we have thousands. Yes, Ranji Trophy has always been there, but now the money infused in the game is so much that even if you don't make it to the top 20 and make it to the top 500, which is a much larger pool, you'll probably be able to, you know, sustain it as a career, and financially you're more secure that way. But in the 1990s, the early 2000s, it was a very different sort of a time. And parents' reluctance and parents' lack of contribution to that end is quite understandable, right? It was a risky proposition, an impossible dream in a way, like Gopal says. Omi, on the other hand, is the dumb one in the group. And there are a lot of theories that have traveled around why Omi is so stupid. He focuses on his... obviously, he comes from a family of priests, so that religious attention, that religious bias is there. And as far as his career is concerned, he doesn't really do what he'll do next. He's much like Ishan, he's traveling in the same boat, probably just a tad more dumb, right? There are a lot of theories, like I said. Someone says that a cork ball hit him in the head when he was in class 6, and that is why he's so stupid. It's just funny theories that travel in small towns. Anyway, at the onset of the novel, Govind comes up with an idea for all three of them. He comes up with a business proposition which would help all three of them, you know, get on their feet, start making money, start getting respect. Not just from their families, but also outside. Ishan and Omi, they had heard enough of these business propositions before and they were not really interested. But this time, the one thing that was different was this project was related to cricket. And that is what got Ishan and Omi really interested in the project. Govind's plan was to open a sports shop where they'll be selling cricket products, essentially. Why did he need the other two? One, because he thought of himself as a parent to both of them. All three of them loved each other. And he considered himself to be the most responsible one, rightly so. Two, Govind needed their help. Ishan's expertise in cricket and, you know, his almost celebrity status as one of the most popular cricketers from the area, he had that local status, would definitely help. And Omi, on the other hand, could help them get the shop. Govind had no money whatsoever, or all three of them had no money whatsoever to pay the rent. And not just the rent, there was the deposit of the new shop, etc., etc. There was a shop which was recently vacated in the temple premises. Temple premises, which is essentially owned and managed by Govind's family. So, Omi's family. So, Govind asked him that, get us the shop, get us a 2-month rent waiver, and we are good to go. So, everybody had a part to play. The three of them agreed, and in spite of a lot of reluctance from different quarters, from Ishan's family, and, you know, not really having a hope, but at least he was doing something now instead of just watching cricket all day, they started. And a couple of months later, they had done well. They were on their way. Yes, it was a shop inside temple premises, but cricket is such a big thing in this country, and Bhagat goes into a lot of detail discussing the passion that people had or have for this game, three of them included. And 3 months later, one night when they're drinking in a dry state, getting alcohol was very difficult for them. They were just kind of revisiting the whole journey that they had taken. They had paid the rent off. They were in a stable financial condition. They had done well, right? And as much as Ishan and Omi were just satisfied with what they had, Govind, the entrepreneur, the young entrepreneurial spirit of this country, which is reflected in Govind, he had already set his eyes on the future. He wanted a shop in a mall. There was a new and upcoming mall in Navrangpura, another area in Ahmedabad. where he wanted to buy a shop, which he thought was the future of this particular industry, and rightly so. He had been collecting money. They still needed a lot. It was a decent 1,10,000 deposit. Not the kind of money they had on themselves at the moment. But the plan was to do it as quickly as possible. And they did. Everyone contributed. I mean, both Ishan and Govind did. They agreed with Govind's plan. And that's how they went ahead. Obviously, everything cannot be smooth sailing, and whenever you feel you're achieving something, trouble is just around the corner at times. The friendship of these three guys, the business, the entire business idea, the entire success was now hampered by two incidents. The first one was a natural disaster. The second one, though, was a man-made disaster. They got through the natural disaster eventually, right? With hope, with work, hard work, they achieved more success. But it was the man-made disaster that broke the three of them, that broke everything they had ever thought was dear to them. And things just went up in smoke. The natural disaster that happened was they had contributed enough money, the deposit was collected for the Navrangpura mall shop, and Govind had, you know, paid everything, and the mall was under construction. It was 6 floors were ready. And then we had the Bhuj earthquake, which I'm sure all of us remember. Bhuj, the city, as much as it was 300 kilometers away from Ahmedabad, was the epicenter of the earthquake. Bhuj was completely destroyed. Millions of structures came down. Hundreds of people died. And amongst those millions of structures, one belonged to Govind. The 6 stories that had been set up so far of the mall, everything turned into rubble. There was no mall. There was nothing. And who do you blame? God. And who do you complain to? God. Eventually, Govind was so taken aback by this obvious loss, financial, emotional, and such a huge setback. In Govind's own words, he says, you can plan and you can make an error in your business planning, and then you can suffer a loss. It's understandable. But how do you accept something like this? It's so unfair. And he also realized that in the greater scheme of things, his loss meant practically nothing. People had lost lives. People had lost homes. People had lost everything. Bhuj was practically all rubble. There was nothing. And yet, like most human beings do, it was very hard for him to see beyond his own loss, which is essentially financial, and yes, it has become an impediment to his growth for now. The other thing that Govind wanted to get away from was the involvement of Omi's uncle, Omi's mama, essentially Bittu mama, who was the person who used to manage the shop. He had already done them favors by waiving the rent for the initial couple of months, etc. He was working with a character which is referred to as Parikji. For the local, for the local chapter of the National Hindu Party. That is the name that it has been referred to. Parikji is described as a guide, as a mentor by Bittu Mama. He's completely dedicated to that man. And the kind of influence that he exerts, the kind of political activism that he focuses on, just never sits right with Govind. Even the fact that Govind himself is an agnostic, and it is something that Bittu Mama finds really hard to understand, etc. All those things and the kind of conversations that happen and the kind of influence that he has over them, the kind of power that he has over them, was something that Govind wanted to run from. But now there was nothing he could do. He was on the bed. He was so taken aback by this loss and by the earthquake, he stayed inside the house for a long time. Meanwhile, Ishan and Omi have already opened the shop, they've started working. Testament to the fact that these two have become more responsible during this entire process. And as much as they did not disturb Govind and, you know, wanted him to rest, etc., they opened the shop because you have to restart. And that was the only way forward. When Govind is finally informed of this, he goes back to the shop and, you know, try to find a way again. It was not a great time. See, cricket is, as much as it's a huge passion in this country, it's still a sport, right? And when people are losing lives, when people are losing homes, playing cricket is the last thing on anybody's mind. So they needed some sort of a miracle to actually come out of it. People were not buying sports stuff with the same intensity that they were buying before the earthquake. And then the miracle happened. The miracle that Chetan Bhagat refers to here is, and every cricket lover in this country would definitely know that match. It was a test match in 2001 at Eden Gardens in Kolkata, where in the middle of the Indian-Australian series, and where Australians were dominating India, it was a time when Australia was the superpower in world cricket, something that India has transformed itself into over the last 5-10 years. India was never the favourite, in spite of the fact that the series was being played in India. They had already lost the first game of the series. And Ishan, Omi, the kind of crazy fans they were, they would watch cricket on the TV in the shop all day. And even after the first innings, Australia had managed to reach a decent score of 400 odd something, in spite of Harbhajan Singh, you know, introducing himself to the world as a superstar. They had lost 8 wickets for a few runs, they were under 200, and then suddenly they reached 445. Ishan was very disturbed, and he was just echoing responses or opinions of any fan in this country. India collapsed very early the next day, and by day 3, follow-on was imposed. And Chetan Bhagat goes into a lot of detail explaining cricket to people who don't understand. I would not be able to do this here in this video, but history was created in that match. It was just one of those very, very few incidents in world cricket where a team, and in its purest form, test cricket, where a team was asked to follow on, and yet they found a way not just to draw it, which would have been a very decent result and a great fight back in itself, they went on to win that game. And he talks in detail about a sensational day, probably the best day for Indian cricket ever, where two Indian batsmen, Vijay Lakshman and Rahul Dravid, did not lose a single wicket to all 11 of the Australian bowlers. They tried everybody. It was two men standing on the wicket, humiliating the world champions, humiliating the best team in the world. India won that match on the final day after Sourav Ganguly, against popular opinion, decided to declare. And this was the miracle that the Team India cricket shop, owned by Govind, Omi and Ishan, needed. It just brought people back into the grounds. The business picked up. During the earthquake, a lot of distributors, a lot of people who were working in this industry, their businesses had collapsed completely. And Govind was now ready to take advantage. They became big in terms of sales. They tied up with Kendriya Vidyalayas, with schools, started supplying them sports stuff, materials. And they were back on track. During all this while, Bittu Mama has already been focused, and he's tried to, you know, at least get Omi on board in terms of helping out with the Hindu party. We are also put in touch with another party through the character of Ali's father, Mr. Nasser. Ali is a talent, a prodigy that these three people identify in the local community. Ishan had been hearing a lot about this young 12-year-old boy who had come from a different school. He had been studying in a madrasa before, as we later find out. And now he had come into the school because his father wanted him to study science and mathematics. And he was just a gifted cricketer. When they looked at him for the first time, he looked like a prodigy for, you know, being a musician or being an artist. And there he was. I mean, nobody could understand how he was doing it. Even when Ishan bowled that one over to him, obviously he couldn't complete the over because of his headaches and whatnot. He smashed him to all parts of the park. For a 12-year-old boy who practically looked like a girl in terms of physical structure, and he was very weak, almost malnourished. I mean, not my words, Chetan Bhagat was the one who has used these things. And the three friends, and Ishan most importantly, was adamant on making sure that this talent does not go to waste. Chetan Bhagat takes us through a series of, you know, corruption in India, even in sports. How talent sometimes is overwritten by nepotism and whatnot. How people like Ali, this protege, will have to be protected from the system itself so that India can have a great cricketer when he finally reaches that age, when he is able to learn the basics of the game right. There was a lot of work to do, and Ishan focused solely on training Ali. The next incident, however, they obviously went and had a conversation with Ali's father, because, you know, you can't really coach someone that way. until you have that approval from their parents. And he came across in direct contrast with Parikji and Bittu Mama. He was working with the secular party. And his views on Hindu-Muslim issues in this country, his views on tolerance, are much more in sync with the modern young Indian. In contrast to what Parikji and Bittu Mama say, you have to read it to really understand it. But it was not a religious philosophy. The secular party is being referred to as... I mean, he gives so many wonderful examples of how Indians, and especially when it comes to Hindu-Muslim topics, because the entire novel is set in the backdrop of Ayodhya, and eventually the man-made disaster that happens because of it. While Bittu Mama and Parikji were focused on Ayodhya and, you know, making sure that car savers are going from Ahmedabad, like from the rest of the country, to Ayodhya and serve. And there was this question of how tolerant should a Hindu be is being asked again and again by Parikji, and where should we draw the line. The secular party, on the other hand, and especially Mr. Nasir Ali, he focuses on the fact that the Hindu-Muslim rivalry in India is like you go to a restaurant, and two people go into a restaurant, and you ask for a plate of food each. But the restaurant owner or the manager or the chef, whoever is there, he gives you one plate and he says that is all you'll get. And now the two people start fighting over it. Eventually someone tells them, why don't you just share it? All this while everybody has forgotten about the issue that they should have been given two plates. So that is how Mr. Nasir thinks about the whole Hindu-Muslim problem in this country. And with the recurrent themes that are prevailing in the undertone of the novel so far, Ayodhya and Babri Masjid, and the problems in Gujarat, he made a lot of sense, to each his own, I guess. He refers to certain examples of chimpanzees and whatnot, which I've shared earlier on the Instagram page. The man-made disaster happens soon enough. There was a train of car sevaks coming back from Ayodhya. The coach S6 of Sabarmati Express was burned down with all the people trapped inside it, children, women, priests, who all burned to death in Gothra. Something again that has been taken from reality, the test match in Eden Gardens, the Gothra incident, it's all based on real incidents that happened in this country, one of the worst things that could really happen. And in the aftermath of that, it was very difficult for people to control their emotions, especially for someone like Bittu Mama, who had lost his son in the Sabarmati Express. A very young son who's coming back from Ayodhya. Chetan Bhagat then describes in detail the kind of violence that erupts in different parts of the country, especially in Gujarat and especially in Ahmedabad. Ishan, Omi and Govind, they had Ali with them. He was under their protection. They were still in the SBI compound where they used to train every morning and where they used to party at night. And Ali's safety was paramount to them. Eventually, Bittu Mama and his gang of goons and thugs realize that Ali is with these people and he comes to kill him. And Bittu Mama accepts that he has already killed his father and his entire family, Ali's father and his entire family. And Ishan, Govind and Omi, they were just completely dedicated to saving Ali's life. And the aftermath of what happens during that night, Ali is very severely injured on his wrist, which threatens the future in his game. Omi, the son of the priest, is killed by Bittu Mama. He has killed his own nephew now, after losing his son. And he's still angry. Ishan and Govind completely fall apart because Ishan comes to know about the affair of Govind and his younger sister Vidya, who Govind had been tutoring for a while. And the novel ends in heartbreak, and it's very tragic. Throughout the text, Bhagat also takes us through all the problems that we had in, you know, Indian sports and Indian cricket especially, and how Australia in contrast was doing things in such a wonderful manner. Ishan and Govind and Omi, they also went to Australia, taking Ali there for a week, arranging it somehow, just because they had the right intentions and the right spirit. And it's in Australia where they see the contrast in services, basic facilities, government programs, and how a sportsman is supposed to be dedicated to his sport, in spite of being who he is. Sportsmen in Australia, for example, are not treated like celebrities and heroes and gods like we do in our country. They are sportsmen. It reminds me of one of very famous MS Dhoni dialogues where he says, "We are all national servants on national duty." That's it. So, as much as people love this game in this country, and as much as that passion is very visible and vibrant and very good in terms of everything, in terms of business, in terms of how it makes the entire country feel and how it unites us, it's a beautiful thing. But the Australian setup was much more successful. How they had completely redesigned their sporting facilities and scholarship programs after the Mexican Olympics, where they had a disaster. And how now Australia is dominating certain games consistently, and even in Olympics, they are among the top 5 nations in the world. So that is something to watch out for. Those contrasts, we can only learn from those. And the eventual tragedy. And then the novel comes back after Omi's death and after Ishan and Govind have completely split from each other. Ishan never forgave him for what he did. And as much as Vidya, Ishan's sister, is still in love with Govind and tries to get in touch with him even after these incidents, he never really responds. As much as he loves her too, he never really responds because of how his and Ishan's relationship has suffered. Towards the end of the novel, the only thing left for the two of them was Omi's mother, who had lost her son, who was the owner of the shop. She requested Ishan and Govind to take the shop back. And when they said they won't be able to work with each other, because Ishan was insistent that he would never work with Govind, she said this is the condition. So they ended up creating a separation in the shop. And as much as Govind focused on stationery and books now, Ishan continued to sell cricket products and sports products, essentially. Both of them, all this while collecting money to be able to pay for the surgery that Ali needed, a surgery that had a 70-30 chance of success, and which required a lot of money. 5 lakh rupees at that time was a huge amount for the both of them. And Ishan was working towards collecting, or eventually getting to that amount, saving everything that he can. Govind is also doing the same. Eventually, in some time, Ishan was able to, in 3 years, if I remember correctly, Ishan was able to collect 2 lakh rupees, and Govind had already collected 3 lakh rupees. And one fine day, Govind goes with that box of money, that envelope of money, to Ishan and says, on the other side of the shop, and says, "Take this, get a surgery done." Ishan wears a cricket batting glove, picks up that envelope like it's something not to be touched, something very impure, and throws it back at him, and he says, "I do not need your money." That is the day Govind decides to end his life. And that is when, during the night, while he's popping sleeping pills, he writes an email to Chetan Bhagat, where the novel started in the first place. And now we are back in the hospital. Before leaving the hospital, after hearing the entire story, Bhagat informs Govind's mother to, in return inform Vidya and Ishan's family that he's here and this is what has happened. The novel ends eventually with Ishan and Govind making up, Vidya openly expressing her love for Govind, and hopefully they would get married at the end of it. And towards the end, we are also able to discover that the surgery was successful. And Ali was now batting exactly like he used to before, with the same gift, with the same skill, and with everything that Ishan had taught him. It's a story of patriotism. It's a story of business. It's a story of friendship. It's a story of love. It's a story of rules. It's a story of breaking those rules. And it's a story of love overpowering everything and allowing people to forgive each other. It's a story which focuses on natural disasters, which human beings can still get through, whatever the loss they have inherited from natural disasters. Together they do have the ability to get around it, but the man-made disasters, those are the ones that we need to be wary of. Those are the ones which have actually ruined this country. Bhagat reflects very severely on corruption, on religious politics, on how people are divided in this country, among a lot of other things. One of the greatest things that I've personally felt about Chetan Bhagat is, if you pick up a book, right, I understand. That is why I started with Salman Rushdie and Namrudi Roy. It's not the same language. It's not that refined, if I may. But the fact is, he has introduced so many young, new readers to the English language. Nobody can doubt that. And the most important aspect of, even if you're not a reader, one of the most exciting aspects of his books is, you pick up a novel and once you start reading, you very quickly realize that it's been 100 pages. Owing to that easy language and owing to themes, owing to relationships, which is just like you, like the young people in this country. And you just realize that you've gone through 100 pages and it makes you feel happy because, oh my God, I'm reading so fast, I'm getting good, oh, I have a reading ability now. It's like a movie, you can finish it in one go. It's not a novel that you have to, you know, carry on for a week or an even longer time. You can just read it in one go. For me, it's around four and a half hours every time I pick up a novel. And it's like watching a Netflix movie. It keeps you engrossed. It keeps you awake. It keeps you interested. It keeps you on your toes because a lot is happening. And it's relatable, especially to the young people in this country. It's relatable. It's the same shit that you and I face every day. It's expressed in the same language, which is easy for everybody to understand. Yes, he does it on purpose. It's not that he doesn't have the vocabulary to, maybe not Shashi Tharoor, nobody has that vocabulary, but he has the vocabulary to, you know, enhance and give some ornamental value to his language. And there are moments when you see it, but then he checks himself because he understands the audience that he is writing for. And I don't think there's anything wrong with that. Read the book. If you like it, let me know. If you like the summary, please share with anyone who you think needs it. This is Harshvardhan, the English teacher, signing off.